Thanks for joining us for Ruth Institute's podcast. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org. We seek to promote and strengthen traditional marriage. I encourage you to sign up for our free e-newsletter at the website, which has information on what we're doing around the country and how you can be involved. Dr. J hosts From the Front Lines of the Culture War on Catholic Radio of San Diego. Today, she's interviewing Brad Wilcox, director of the National Marriage Project at the University of Virginia, associate professor of sociology at the University of Virginia, and a member of the James Madison Society at Princeton University. They're discussing the so-called decline of marriage in American culture. Turns out it's not across the board, and certain demographics are more prone to experience the breakdown of marriage than others. They view this trend through various lenses, including the sexual revolution, the extremes of the feminist movement, and the rise of the me generation.
Welcome to Catholic Radio of San Diego. I'm the founder and president of the Ruth Institute, a national interfaith educational organization promoting lifelong married love to college students and young adults. And we're based right here in San Diego County. You're listening to Catholic Radio of San Diego. That's CatholicRadioofSanDiego.com. What happens when marriage disappears from a society? Is marriage disappearing from the middle class here in America? And what can Catholics do about it? Tonight, on the front lines of the culture wars, we'll be talking about these important questions with Dr. Bradford Wilcox of the University of Virginia. Dr. Wilcox is associate professor of sociology at UVA, the president of the National Marriage Project, and the lead author of an important report called When Marriage Disappears from Middle America. On the line with us from Virginia, we have Professor Brad Wilcox of the University of Virginia. Brad, how are you doing?
I'm doing well, Jenny. It's great to be here.
Hey, I'm so glad to have you on. I was looking over your report today. And tell us, Brad, is marriage in decline across the board in the United States or just in some social classes?
You know, Jenny, despite the fact that we've been seeing all these stories of people like Arnold Schwarzenegger and John Ensign and Mark Sanford, these kind of high-profile examples of marital misbehavior. In reality, marriage is doing pretty well among the educated and the more affluent circles in the U.S. Divorce is down. Non-marital childbearing is still quite low for this group. But for people who do not have college degrees, for most middle Americans and for many working-class and poor Americans, we're actually seeing a real retreat from marriage as marked by things like declines in marital quality, high levels of divorce, and growing rates of non-marital childbearing.
Now, do you have any sense, Brad, of what accounts for any of these changes? Is this some kind of long-term thing that we're finally seeing the bottom line of a lot of trends that have been in place for a while, or is there something new on the horizon?
Well, you know, we've noticed in the broader society that marriage has been in a difficult situation for the poor and for African Americans really since the late 1960s with the onset of the Cultural Revolution and shifts in the economy. But that basic pattern now has moved up the social ladder into the heart of the middle class and to basically people who've got a high school degree who historically were kind of the bedrock of American, middle America. Those Americans are now facing many more difficulties when it comes to things like divorce, when it comes to things like having kids outside of wedlock, and when it comes to having, you know, happy marriages over their lifetimes.
Now, you mentioned the term cultural revolution, Brad. What exactly do you mean by that? What were some of the things that took place in the 1960s that you think are particularly relevant to what's happening here?
Well, I think three things are particularly noteworthy. The first is the sexual revolution, which basically, you know, told people they could have, you know, sex on their own terms, according to their desires, whatever those might be, and really disconnecting sex from marriage and trying to break apart the links between marriage, sex, and parenthood as well, fueled, of course, in part by the contraceptive revolution of that time. So that's one point, the sexual sort of shift in mores in the late 60s and early 1970s. Another thing that's worth noting is that we saw the rise of a feminist mindset in particularly in the 70s. While it wasn't entirely bad, what was, I think, problematic about that was it encouraged, I think, many women to sort of think that they could go it alone when it came to raising a family, that, you know, a mom on her own could do just as good a job as a mother and a father. And that, of course, is not correct, and in many ways. The third thing I think was really important about that time frame was the rise of a kind of what's been called a kind of me generation, of people who were focusing on their own desires rather than sort of putting the needs of their spouse, especially their children, first. And that kind of me generation was particularly susceptible to the divorce mentality that kicked in the 1970s. So those three things, I think. Go ahead.
No, so none of those things are particularly relevant to the economy or particularly have to do with the economy. These are all kind of attitudinal or cultural shifts you're talking about here.
They are, but I think the economy is also a big player in all this.
Okay.
Because at this very same time, we see the erosion of many working class stable jobs happening in, you know, many industrial centers throughout the United States. So that's problematic, of course, because, you know, for much of our nation's history, and for, I think, most modern cultures, having access to decent jobs for men is crucial to starting, a marriage and keeping a marriage together, in terms of having the husband make a decent financial contribution to his family. If he can't do that, he's much more likely to think he is not worthy of being a husband, and also to be viewed that same way by the women in his life, or the woman in his life.
Right, and so the feminist mindset had something to do with that as well, because the idea that you can't favor a man because he has a family, of course, that was completely forbidden. so some of these things play into one another, I think, probably. So Brad Wilcox, tell us, what harm do you think there is if marriage does disappear from society? What's the problem with all this? I imagine we have a lot of people out here in Southern California who are just saying, well, so what if people don't get married?
Well, marriage is really the sort of the classic institution designed to connect kids, to particularly to their fathers, to form a lifelong relationship with their fathers and allow their dads to give them not just the financial support they need to thrive, but also to give them the emotional, the social, and the spiritual support and direction that they need to thrive. And we know also, too, that moms tend to be better parents also when they are married, because they've got someone to spell them when they're tired, when they're exhausted from their kids, as they occasionally can be. They also have someone who can kind of, give them social support, give them emotional support, as a parent. And the other thing to note here, of course, is that both mom and dad have their own kinship networks, their own friendship networks, and they can bring those things together on behalf of raising their kids in a successful fashion. So, both moms and dads bring their own networks and their own gifts to the parenting enterprise, and marriage is that institution that keeps them together over their own lifetimes and, of course, over the first 18 years of their kids' lives as well.
Now, Brad, I'm used to hearing these statistics about, for example, out-of-wedlock childbearing. We hear the number that 40% of U.S. children are born out of wedlock, and over 70% of African-American children are born out of wedlock. The thing that was striking to me about your report is that your report is showing that some of the things that we think of as having to do with race, in fact, have to do more with class and poverty, right? And so it's not just blacks who are having a lot of out-of-wedlock childbearing. It's a lot of poor whites, too, or lower class white. So could you do you think that's true as a general proposition? Do you think this is a more of a class situation or a race situation? What do you think?
Well, it's both a class and a race situation. I think most people are aware of the fact that African-American women now have high rates of non-marital childbearing, but these things are all deeply stratified by class. And by that I mean there's basically a big difference between people who are better educated and those who are less educated. So take whites, for instance. From 1982 to the present, among college-educated white women, there was no increase in non-marital childbearing, despite all those stories in the New York Times about women having, kids through exotic artificial reproductive technologies. That's just not happening for white college-educated women on average. But by contrast, for white women who have a high school degree, and that's, they stop at a high school degree, They go from having a rate of labral childbearing of 5% in 1982 to 34% today, a dramatic increase, obviously, more than sixfold between 1982 and the present. And so what that suggests, I think, to us is that there is kind of this dramatic erosion of marriage in middle America. And it's not just a black or Latino thing, it's also a white thing for whites who are not college educated.
And those women, by and large, are not using some kind of exotic and expensive artificial reproductive technology techniques. Those women are having relationships with men that are not permanent relationships. Is that fair to say, Brad Wilcox?
Well, that's basically true. What's happening really since the late 1980s is that almost all of the growth in non-marital childbearing can be attributed to couples having kids in a cohabiting relationship. So it's not the case that women are having babies outside of marriage with just on their own. What they're doing instead is they're cohabiting with someone and becoming pregnant and having a baby. And so, you know, in my view, you know, we've had this notion, I think, really since the late 60s that our crisis now is about single parenthood and divorce. Well, today, I think our crisis is about cohabitation. And that is a crisis, of course, because cohabitation is much less stable than is marriage. What we know, for instance, is that a child who is born to a cohabiting couple as compared to a married couple is three times more likely to see mom and dad split by age five compared to a child who is born to a couple who are married to one another.
So, by age five, that's unbelievable. Unbelievable.
Exactly.
Can you tell us a little bit more about why you think cohabitation is really not a good substitute for marriage and what the problem is with that?
Well, you know, it's actually, you know, it's quite simple at some level. You know, I joke in my class about this idea that, you know, you don't have a couple going down, you know, their apartment complex for that first day when they move in together with, you know, the music and the friends and the family all gathered watching them, you know, as they begin this wonderful new adventure, which is cohabitation. Instead, they just do it on their own terms. And that can mean that there's some important level of commitment. It can mean that, you know, they're just doing it to save rent. And because cohabitation is not institutionalized, that it doesn't have, you know, kind of rules to govern it, doesn't have a clear expectation, a clear horizon for that relationship, it doesn't have the same level of trust and security as marriage typically affords. It doesn't have the same buy-in from friends and family as marriage typically gets. And so it's just a much more fragile relationship. And as a consequence, there's more infidelity, there's more violence, and there's much less stability. And all those things, of course, are not great for children.
And, you know, in your report, I see towards the back of the report there's been a steady increase in the number of high school seniors who think cohabiting is actually a good idea. You've got a question, you ask them, it's usually a good idea for a couple to live together before getting married in order to find out whether they really get along. Brad Wilcox, 32% of girls agreed with that in 1976, and 63% of high school senior girls agree with that today. What are they thinking? Do you have any sense what they're thinking about that?
Well, you know, I think part of the story here is that, you know, for some of these kids, they've seen their parents who've gotten divorced, or they've seen their friends' parents get a divorce, and they're trying to figure out how they can forge ahead in this world without making the same mistakes that their parents did. And they think, you know, well, if I live with someone ahead of time, I'll actually have a better sense of whether or not we're actually supposed to get married, you know, are supposed to move on to kind of a deeper commitment of some sort. And there's a kind of, you know, logic to that thought. I think that's part of the story here. And I think the other part of the story here is that because our norms have shifted so much in the broader society to accept things like non-marital sex, cohabitation's a pretty, you know, it's a pretty, you know, nice way to organize your life. You get all the benefits of marriage to a certain degree, without any of the responsibilities. So that's also, I think, why we're seeing such a dramatic increase in cohabitation and its popularity, even among young adults like the group you just mentioned.
Yeah, and you know what? I really feel like, Brad, this is where the Ruth Institute comes in, to educate young adults that those kind of attitudes are really counterproductive. You know, that it's simply not true that if you live together prior to marriage that you're going to have a better marriage, or you're going to have a lower probability of divorce. Quite the contrary. And so part of our mission at the Ruth Institute is to educate young people about that this kind of attitude, this kind of behavior is actually counterproductive. It doesn't matter what your faith tradition is. It doesn't matter what your sexual orientation, or whether you're male or female or white or black or anything, that those attitudes are really not going to work out very, very well for you. So now before the break, I was also asking you a little bit about this idea of a new caste system. You know, there's Kay Heimowitz has this idea, and even a book by a title similar to that. But what she's saying is that, and I gather your report is saying the same thing, that the absence of marriage amongst the poor makes it even more likely that they're going to stay poor, and it widens the gap actually between the rich and the poor. And is that a money thing, or is that an education thing, or is that a true thing? First of all, am I just making that up?
No, you're exactly right, Dr. J. What we're seeing is that there's been a kind of emergence of a two-nation pattern here in the U.S., where people who are college-educated and more affluent are succeeding more and more at marriage every year since the 1980s. And everyone who doesn't have, or say, well, maybe people don't have a college degree, who don't have as much affluence, are struggling more and more to get and stay married. And that's problematic because it hurts both the adults and the kids in many working class and poor communities who are, you know, doubly disadvantaged by having less economic resources, less economic security, and less family stability, and less family support from, you know, from an intact marriage. So we are seeing this growing divide in American life. And the family domain just reinforces the other divide that we see economically in this country.
You know, I can remember seeing reports where if you look at the involvement of a father, for example, in a child's life, it reduces their behavior problems, and it has a number of other benefits to the child. But if you look at it closely, having an involved father is almost the same as having an educated father. You know, in other words, it's quite a substantial advantage, and if people could get married and stay married, it would really be advantageous to them. So any thoughts about what's involved in getting married and staying married, Brad?
Well, I think what's crucial to succeeding today when it comes to marriage is a couple of things. One is sharing a strong religious faith together is clearly linked in the data to succeeding in marriage. You know, a second is having a commitment to viewing marriage as a lifelong institution, as a lifelong enterprise that's done together is crucial. Having a commitment to communication and mutual sacrifice on behalf of your spouse and your family, those things are crucial to making it work. Having family and friends who are with you and behind you, who aren't trying to undercut your relationship, encouraging you, you know, to do things on the weekend that, you know, are good for your marriage. It's important just to have a good network, basically, and you know, that's also crucial making marriage work today. And I think, finally, on the financial side of things, I think the ideal is to have a husband who has a decent, stable job. Now, that doesn't mean the wife, you know, can't work, but really in terms of, you know, the, sort of how you organize it, typically, I'm just saying, of course, there are exceptions, but typically the ideal is to have a husband who's got a decent, stable job that provides a certain level of financial stability and security to the family. And
gives the wife something to look up to. You know, I mean, I think sometimes when competition can develop between husband and wife, and that's never a good thing, I think, to have that happen. And you're right that that a woman has to respect her husband for whatever's involved in that for that particular couple. It's very important that the woman respect her husband.
And he may not work at a job that makes a ton of money, but if he's a good teacher, for instance, or if he is a good fireman or whatever else it might be, you know, that's going to be a source of respect on her part. It's going to make him feel like a good husband. It's going to be, an important glue in their marriage moving forward.
Yes, and you know, I was looking in your report, again, toward the back of the report, and you've got this little table back there saying your chances of divorce may be lower than you think. And one of the things I liked about that report is that you're commenting on the 50% chance of divorce, but then you say, well, now, wait a second, you in particular may have a lower chance of divorce than 50%, and you list some risk factors, some things that give you a benefit, and I'm struck by how many of these things you actually have some control over as an individual. The top one is that if you have more money, you have a lower chance of divorce. Well, duh, okay? But not everybody can control that. Not everybody can make it so that they're going to be a higher income person. But not everybody can make it so they're going to graduate from college. But putting those two things aside, the other things on your list are things that people do have some control over. So the first one is having a baby 7 months or more after marriage versus having your baby before marriage, right? So if you get married when you get pregnant rather than just, you know, hanging around together, the chances of the union remaining stable are much higher. Is that right, Brad? Am I reading that correctly?
Yeah, I mean, the basic idea here, this is not rocket science, is that, you know, people who wait to have their kids in marriage do a lot better than people who have kids, you know, prior to marriage, including, you know, including getting pregnant before they're married.
And what I'm looking at your table is that factor reduces your risk of divorce by 24%. Having a college education reduces your risk of divorce by 25%. So it's basically the same as finishing college. The reduction in your risk factor is basically the same as finishing college. Likewise, coming from an intact family of origin versus having divorced parents, that reduces your risk factor by 14%. Well, you can't do anything about that. If your mom and dad are divorced, that's not up to you. But compared with that, having a religious affiliation, which you mentioned, sharing religious faith, also reduces your risk factor by 14%. Well, you can control that part of it. So you can't get the part that you can control versus the part you can't control. I think it's helpful, very helpful and hopeful for people to realize that there are some things that you can do yourself that will increase your probability of a successful, long-lasting marriage.
Yeah, and one thing actually we didn't talk about, but it's worth also surfacing because it came out in the analysis for the report, is that couples who had fewer sexual partners prior to marriage had, you know, dramatically lower odds of divorce than couples where, you know, one spouse or both spouses had, you know, a number of sexual partners prior to the marriage.
Now, you know, that's a very interesting point because, again, that's something that we are concerned about with the Ruth Institute, that we talk to our college students about that all the time, that having fewer sexual partners increases your probability of having a happier marriage later on. So that you're not abstaining from sex just to abstain from sex. You've got a purpose or a reason behind that. And for a lot of our young people that we work with in the Ruth Institute, that's a big motivator for them. Have you seen young adults like that as well, Brad Wilcox?
Yes. No. I teach a large sociology to family class, and it's a very heterogeneous group. It's a very diverse group. We have, you know, conservative, moderate, liberal students in that group. But I think, you know, when we get to the point in the class where we discuss the impact of, you know, multiple relationships on your marital future, you can just kind of see the lights go on in the eyes of many of these students because they understand, because many of them, of course, have been harmed by a relationship that went south. And they realize, you know, if I accumulate a history of two or three or four broken sexual partnerships, that's going to shape how I look at the opposite sex, how I think about marriage, how much I can trust someone, how I deal with conflict, and in ways that are not going to be helpful to sustaining a strong, lifelong marriage.
That is a very valuable insight, and like you say, you can get the kids to see that themselves from their own experience. And if they haven't had the experience themselves, they've probably seen their roommates go through two or three of these episodes,
yeah, exactly.
You know, so they can really relate to what you're saying. So, in a sense, it's the ancient teaching of Christianity that one should be chaste until marriage, and that marriage is the proper context for sexual activity. That ancient teaching is being affirmed basically by these sociological archaeological findings. Today we're talking with Professor Brad Wilcox of the University of Virginia and the National Marriage Project, and the author of a very important report called When Marriage Disappears from Middle America. Brad, before I forget, could you tell people where they can go on the World Wide Web to download this report themselves? Because I know a lot of our listeners are going to be interested in all of these things we're talking about. Where can they get it?
They can go to stateofourunions.org. So it's all one word, stateofourunions.org, to get this report.
Okay, that sounds great. And I'll stick it up on my website, too, at ruthinstitute.org, just in case, so people can learn more about it. Now, we had a caller before the break, so I'd like to ask Lynn for her comment, because I think she's wanting to comment on some of the things we've been talking about before we delve into this question of mothers and fathers. Lynn, how are you?
Hi, Dr. J and Dr. Wilcox. Thank you so much for a great show.
Oh, well, thanks for calling us. Where are you calling from?
I'm calling from Fairfax, Virginia.
Excellent.
And this last week, I've just come about the realization that one of the, if not the most important aspects for success in marriage is the practice of chastity in marriage. I am a Catholic woman, married 26 years, with 6 children, age 9 through 23. And I've just been thinking, later I would like maybe Dr. Wilcox to address how can I communicate this concept of chastity to non-Catholics. And it's very important not only to teach our young children, college students, no premarital sex, and to live the virtues and to live this commitment of purity before they get married. But people I've been talking to are, what chastity within marriage? And what that is it develops the virtue beyond the flesh, beyond giving into selfishness. And it's through natural family planning or fertility awareness. But I believe that also sexual relations within marriage are very deep and loving. When you have a period of abstinence, you look forward to the renewal. And I know that maybe less than 5% of Catholics will practice NFP, but to those Catholics listening, I want to make a strong appeal to examine the idea of chastity in marriage.
Well, Lynn, that's a marvelous comment. Dr. Wilcox, do you have any comment to make to Lynn?
Well, I think she's making a good point, certainly a countercultural point, one that we don't think about that often. And I would just sort of extend it by saying I think that this notion of chastity in marriage is particularly challenging, today with the rise of things like internet pornography, and also with the fact that, we do see people, in a variety of contexts in the workplace, when they're traveling, may be behaving in ways that are, that are unchaste, even though they are married, or they're, giving into, to thoughts and comments that are not chaste. So, I think the challenge is to try to renew an appreciation for chastity both inside and outside of marriage, partly too by cultivating ethic of discretion in terms of, being aware of what you're looking at. And how you're speaking, in social contexts and professional contexts in our day and age.
Well, this is a good time to say that what the Catholic Church teaches about chastity is that chastity is simply rightly ordered sexuality. And so if you're not married, rightly ordered sexuality means abstaining from sex. If you are married, it means directing your sexual activity exclusively to your marriage partner. And I always like to say that it means saying yes to your partner as often as possible. And if you have an agreement between the two of you that you want to postpone having children for whatever reason you may have come to, then that means mutually agreeing to abstain during that period of time as well. So all of these points are very important, and they all have to do with you controlling your sexual activity rather than your life being run by your sexual impulses. So that's a very important thing to learn at an early age, and it's something that you need throughout married life. So, Lynn, thanks so much for your call and comment. That's very helpful, and I'm glad you brought that up. So Brad, I wanted to go back to this question of do kids really need a mom and a dad, and do mothers and fathers really parent differently? Can you tell us a little bit about what you found about that?
Basically, in my review of the research, what I have found is that there are, are distinctive gifts that moms and dads bring to the parenting enterprise. moms tend to excel when it comes to reading their children, understanding their cues, whether their infants' cries or their adolescents', you know, glance at them. They tend to have better communication skills with their kids. They tend to remember more of the talks they've had with their children, all the details, and to follow up on those details. They tend to excel when it comes to nurturing, providing that loving support to their children. By contrast, dads tend to excel when it comes to challenging their kids to get out of the nest, to embrace life's challenges and opportunities. They also have an advantage when it comes to discipline. Their comparative size, strength, even the tone of their voice tends to elicit more obedience, more of a response from their kids, particularly their teenage boys. Dads also excel when it comes to playing with their kids. They tend to engage in much more rough physical play, like, you know, for instance, the dad roughhousing with his 4-year-old son on the living room floor. These are things that dads tend to do in a distinctively paternal way, which benefits their kids. And if you kind of... Go ahead.
You know, I'm sitting here looking. I've got a study here from Judith Stacy and Timothy Bliblarts from last February. They're basically tallying up how much time parents spend doing certain behaviors and activities. And here's the list, because this goes right to what you're saying. Their list of things that they keep track of are time spent talking with children, time spent participating in school-related events, displaying affection and warmth, knowing the names of their children's friends and parents, monitoring homework, etc. Brad Wilcox, what is missing from analyzing parenthood according to a checklist like that? What do you think of their checklist that they're using there?
Well, obviously, that article, as you know, Dr. J, is one that basically is tilting the field towards the kinds of things that moms do.
Exactly. And I mean, I cracked up when I read this list. I'm thinking, what are they even thinking? Oh, my gosh, women are better parents. Who knew? I'm sorry. Go ahead. I could control myself, Brad. You talk.
Yeah, well, no, it's interesting. I mean, I think we all know, you know, families where, the father or the grandfather doesn't do as much in terms of the actual day-to-day stuff, but there's something about his presence in the home that elicits the attention of his, you know, of his sons or daughters, his grandsons, his granddaughters, and it's just his very presence, his maleness, has a certain kind of interest or attraction that goes beyond just, you know, kind of clicking off, you know, one task or another like this particular study did. So they're just missing something, you know, at a deeply ontological level in terms of the way in which having a man present in the home can be really important to a child. And concretely, let me give you kind of two examples here in terms of how this plays out in the real world. The first, that we know that boys who are reared apart from their own fathers, and this is true for boys who are in a single mother home, it's also true, though, for boys who are being raised by a stepfather and their own mom. Those boys are about 2 to 3 times more likely to end up having difficulty with the law and to spend some time in jail or in prison, according to a major study done by my mentor at Princeton, Sarah McClanahan. So, you know, the point is that dads play a crucial role in helping to sort of basically socialize, to civilize their boys, to establish a climate of authority in the home. And when dad's not there, you know, junior's going to be more likely to end up, you know, on the streets and causing trouble of one sort or another.
Well, do you know, Barrett, what I like about what you're saying is that there is a difference between the presence of the parent and the activities of the parent. We've kind of broken ourselves down into pieces so that we've got all these activities that have to get done, and it doesn't really matter who does them. It's just, well, feed the baby, change the baby's diapers, check the homework. But what you're saying is something. There's something much deeper. It's the presence, not just of a male person, but of a particular male person, your own father. It makes a difference. It's not just a male role model. It's the particular person. So it's presence, not just activities. What do you think of that?
Yeah, no, I think that's completely on. And my wife and I are the parents of adoptive children. And adoption is a beautiful thing, but it's still the case when you compare kids who are reared in adoptive homes versus biological intact homes, that on average, the kids who are reared by their own biological parents tend to do better because they have a unique relationship with the very people who brought them into this world. And we can't, I think, you know, I mean, we can try to forget that, we can try to ignore that reality, but it's true nonetheless. But the other point I wanted to make on this whole issue is that dads also matter, not just for their sons when it comes to behavior, but for their daughters when it comes to their sexual behavior. And my colleague Mark Regneris at UT Austin did a study looking at what predicts early sex on the part of girls. And he looked at the quality of the girl's relationship with her mother and with her father. And guess what was more important in predicting early sex for a girl? Mom or dad?
Their dad. Their dad. Their dad teaches them how to be a girl. Go ahead. You explain it.
No, because, yeah, you're completely right. And it's interesting is that, you know, it was the quality of the relationship with the father that predicted whether or not a girl would delay or just forego sex. And the higher the quality of the relationship with dad, the more likely she was to delay or to forego sex as a teenager. So, you know, it's clearly something about having a man of the household who pays attention to you, who is affectionate to you, who, you know, is kind of helping to make you, make good decisions. That was more important than having a mom who was deeply involved in your life. And I think that's the kind of thing that we often forget in these contemporary culture wars.
I really want to know, Brad, how you think all of this applies to Catholics in particular. My first question for you about that is it really true that Catholics and other religious people are no different from the rest of the population with respect to marriage and cohabitation and divorce? You sometimes hear this, boy, those Christians, they're just no better than anybody else. Is that really true?
We have to distinguish here between Catholics who regularly attend Mass and Catholics who do not attend Mass. And, of course, Catholics who attend Mass, who frequent the sacraments, are much more likely to live their lives in accord with Catholic teaching. They're more likely not to have sex before marriage, not to cohabit, and to divorce at lower rates than their fellow Catholics who are not regular Mass goers. So that's of course, a big point of division when it comes to assessing how Catholicism is related to these marriage outcomes.
Is that true of other religious practice as well, Brad? Could you say something comparable about, evangelicals who attend services regularly versus those who don't?
Yeah, no, it is. I mean, basically, Americans who attend church on a regular basis are about 35% less likely to divorce. And if they attend with their spouse, that effect is even stronger. So, shared church attendance is a powerful protector against divorce today.
Now, Brad, what can Catholics do to improve the culture of marriage besides living out their faith, which is kind of what you just said? You're kind of telling us that if we all go to Mass and do the sacraments, we're kind of doing our part already. But I'm sure there's more that you could add. What else can we do to improve the culture of marriage in America?
Well, I think, one thing at the personal level is that we did a study recently, some colleagues and I, that looked at what was the sort of the most powerful predictor, religiously speaking, of strong marriages. And we found was attending church together was a good predictor, but praying together in the home was even that much more powerful as a predictor of happy marriages. So I think, the more you can bring the faith into the home, and integrate it into your life on a day-to-day basis, the happier you'll be as a spouse and the more stable your marriage will be and the better your kids will be, of course, as well. So that's one point, is to think about ways in which you can bring your faith, into your home life. So, for instance, it might be the family says the rosary. You might start saying that on Sunday nights, and then you would extend that into kind of a daily ritual or some other way in which, both the family and the couple can pray together on a daily basis is really important.
So once again, social science is supporting the ancient Christian teaching that the family that prays together stays together. Now, Professor Wilcox, amongst your other virtues, if you don't mind my saying this, you are the father of many, if I could just put it that way. Can you tell us a little bit, if you don't mind, telling us a little bit about your growing family?
Sure. My wife and I were not able to have kids for a number of years, many, many years, in fact. And so we wanted to have kids, and we adopted three kids from Guatemala and then two kids from Ethiopia. And then about 2.5 years ago, my wife got pregnant with twins, twin girls. And we had Catherine and Elizabeth in November of 2009. And then we just had a little baby girl Edith Margaret last week. So we now have 8 children, 5 of whom are adopted and 3 of whom are biological.
Now, it seems to me there was a bit of divine intervention with those twin baby girls from on the part of one of your other children. Is that right? Am I remembering that story right, Brad?
Yeah, that is true. My daughter, Clara, told her preschool teacher that she was going to be having twin sisters, and this was before Danielle was pregnant. And she also had been praying to have twin sisters. So her prayers were answered in this case.
So a little girl with a rosary is a dangerous thing, is what we're trying to say here.
<That's>
Powerful
right.
thing. Now, also, Dr. Wilcox, you're going to be one of our speakers at this summer's Ruth Institute Student Conference, It Takes a Family to Raise a Village. Can you tell us a little bit about your past experiences with the Ruth Institute conferences, It Takes a Family to Raise a Village?
I had a great time 2 years ago speaking to a group of undergraduate and graduate students about why marriage is important for kids and how to go about sort of engaging the steps in what comes to courtship that will enable you to succeed in marriage and family life. And I clearly had the sense from my interaction with the students that these are the kinds of kids, of young adults, we're going to be playing a key role in renewing a culture of love, a civilization of love, not only in this society, but around the world. Because, of course, as you know, there are students who are coming from many countries to this particular event.
Well, that's right. And today happens to be tomorrow's the last day to sign up for to apply for this year's ITAF conference. So if there's anybody out there who is between the ages of 18 and 30, or if you know anybody between the ages of 18 and 30 that you think would be interested in our summer program, our all expenses paid trip to San Diego to participate in this wonderful conference, tell them to get online and apply. And I should also mention that the opening lecture for this year's ITAF will be delivered by yours truly. And that opening lecture will be open to the public, and Professor Wilcox will be with us once again, giving a couple of lectures over the course of the long weekend. So if you'd like to be invited to the part of the program that's open to the public, I would encourage you to sign up for the Ruth Institute electronic newsletter at www.ruthinstitute.org, and we'll keep you informed about all of our activities, including making sure that you get invited to that event that kicks off the ITAF. So I want to just wrap up this program by giving you just a couple of takeaway points for you to think about from based on our discussion here with Professor Brad Wilcox from the University of Virginia. The first thing I want to just remind you of that he talked about was this idea of a new caste system coming about in America, that the educated elites in the United States badmouth marriage. They badmouth marriage in academia, in public policy, and in the media. But they themselves, in fact, are living Ozzie and Harriet lifestyles. Their divorce rate is no higher than in 1982, but they've made it almost impossible for the lower classes to get married and stay married. So that caste division that's happening in America is something that is really quite a striking result of Professor Wilcox's researches. But it's not impossible, by any means. It's not impossible for people to get married and stay married, no matter what your social class might be. And remember that we talked about having a baby at least 7 months after marriage, as opposed to having a baby prior to marriage, actually decreases your chances of divorce by as much as having graduated from college. So you may not be able to make it through college, but by golly, you have some control over when you get married and when you have that baby. Not everybody will make it through college, but you have some control over whether you get married before or after a baby's born. Likewise, you can't control whether your parents stay married or not. But it turns out that by being religious, by taking regular part in religious services, especially with your spouse, that reduces your risk of divorce as much as having parents who are always married to one another. So those of you who have divorced parents, you may think it's not possible for you. You may think it's too hard. You may be scared of marriage. But I want you to know that there's hope for you tonight. I want you to know that it's possible for you to get married and stay married just by doing a few of these simple things. And one of the things you really need to do is to be hopeful and remain hopeful. Don't shack up with your boyfriend or your girlfriend thinking that that's going to be the answer to your problems, because really and truly, and this is the third takeaway you need to have, cohabitation increases your probability of divorce. It does not decrease your probability of divorce, and it also increases your probability of having problems in the relationship.
and having problems within the relationship, problems communicating, problems spending time together, trust problems. All of these kinds of issues are more likely to be happening if you cohabit prior to marriage. So that's another thing that you can do as a young person to increase your probability of having a happy, stable marriage. And the final thing, of course, that you can do is to limit the number of sexual partners that you have. Maybe you haven't been chaste all of your life. Maybe you've already had a few sexual partners. But now's the time to resolve that I want to get married and stay married, and in the name of that future marriage, I'm going to limit my sexual activity, and I'm going to be looking for that right partner, that one and only partner. So, Professor Brad Wilcox from the University of Virginia, thank you so much for being my guest tonight, and thanks to all of you for listening to Catholic Radio of San Diego. I'm Dr. Jennifer Roback Morse, your hostess for From the Front Lines of the Culture Wars. Don't forget to sign up for the Ruth Institute electronic newsletter at www.ruthinstitute.org.
You've just been listening to Dr. J from the Front Lines of the Culture War on Catholic Radio of San Diego, where she and Brad Wilcox discuss the state of marriage in America and some of the cultural practices that contribute to strengthening or weakening it. Check out CatholicRadioofSanDiego.com for more information on the show and what else is going on. Our website is www.ruthinstitute.org, and we're also on Facebook and Twitter. Our podcasts can be found online at ruthinstitute.libsyn.com and iTunes, and as always, they're under a Creative Commons license. The Ruth Institute is a nonprofit educational organization devoted to bringing hope and encouragement for lifelong married love.